In a world where a single organizational misstep or presidential tweet can change everything, Shapeholders require a different approach than true stakeholders. Mark Kennedy has an unmatched range of experiences as a senior executive at Macy's, a U.S. congressman, trade advisor of both Presidents George W. Bush and Barack Obama, and as the current president of the University of North Dakota. Today, Mr. Kennedy will share insights from his book, Shapeholders, Business Success in the Age of Activism. To help you engage shapeholders to sidestep conflict, find ways to profitably collaborate, and when necessary, to win political skirmishes. Please welcome Mark Kennedy.
Thank you so much. I appreciate the Lignite Council having me here today. We're going to talk about how you lead in an age of activism. I've orchestrated this presentation just for you, reinforced with my own photos that I've taken around the world during my travels, to shed light, in this case, on the fact that if you take certain actors and treat them as stakeholders when they have no stake in your success, you may find you miss opportunities to collaborate or you stumble into conflict. If you take those protesting the Keystone Pipeline, right now business strategy calls them stakeholders when the only stake they really want in that pipeline is a stake through its heart. If you think about it, we've expanded our thinking over the years from just focusing on the shareholders' interests to stakeholders. But true stakeholders have a stake in the enterprise. An employee may want more salary. A customer may want a better price value. A supplier may want a better invoice price. A community may want you to pay more taxes or hire more people in the community. But in all cases, they need the organization to exist and to continue to engage them. On the flip side, this is my best photo of shapeholders. They have a much greater flexibility of things they can do to you, either good or bad. So they could be like the lady on the bottom of the photo as it relates to engaging your enterprise. They, just like this tree, is shaped by forces outside of it. Your organization, your industry, is shaped by forces outside of your industry that shapes both the risk and the opportunities that you face. That's why I say shapeholders, those entities that have no stake in your company or industry, but can shape your risk or opportunities, create the environment within state which stakeholders and shareholders operate. And even if you're a nonprofit, like the University of North Dakota, we have a mission, but we have shapeholders around us, the state government and many other actors that shape our future. If you don't learn how to engage these very high voltage actors, you may find it's dangerous. Let's start with political actors. When Donald Trump did this tweet about Boeing, he wasn't really worried about whether this was good or bad for Boeing. Clearly, political actors can affect us. On the regulatory front, one example is that AT&T paid a $6 billion breakup fee because it couldn't accurately predict whether it could get the T-Mobile acquisition approved. If you look at media, Walmart got attacked by New York Times, saying that when they were expanding in Mexico, they used some shady practices. Even though in the years since, this has proven to be a bit of an exaggeration, Walmart still spent $500 million and had 8 executives leave under a cloud. And then you have activists. My favorite is the Girl Scouts that got protested over what their oil was in their Girl Scout cookies. So in all cases, they can shape your future. People that don't think that business is a positive force for good would say that businesses and industries are the heavyweights in Washington and Bismarck and other capitals around the world. But the surprise for me, having been a top 5 executive at one of the 100 largest companies in the country, having been in Congress, having been in academia, and not just here around the world, but helping Pillsbury buy and expand Häagen-Dazs, engaging with political leaders around the world and teaching around the world, One of the biggest surprises for me was that rather than the voice of business being like the roar of a tiger, it was more akin to the meow of a kitten. Not because business and industry isn't big and strong and powerful, it is, but too often when it's engaging with shapeholders, it's tentative, it's reactive, and it's combative. And as a result, you end up paying taxes coming and going and have layer upon layer of regulation imposed on you that it makes it harder for you to conduct your operations. We used to have the invisible hand of Adam Smith guiding the future of our economy. This is my best photo of business in today's very political age. If your industry, if your company gets even close to 30 kilometers an hour, you're gonna reach down from the sky, the hand of government, to help you slow down. Too often, businesses, industries say, I just want to find a way out from this conflict. I just want to put out the fire. And they say these activists, these reporters, these politicians, they just don't understand me. But in truth, oftentimes that those business people don't understand them as well. And so they're like ships passing in the night, and too often ships colliding in the night. When I was in Congress, I had a farmer sit down and tell me he wanted me to focus not on what would increase the price of corn or soybeans by pennies a bushel. He wanted me to focus on the other side of the decimal point, on what increases the price of corn or soybeans by dollars a bushel. I'm here to say that dealing with the non-market, dealing with shapeholders, is the other side of the decimal point. It's the dollars in a share side of the decimal point, because most market opportunities, whatever you make, is well plowed. There's a lot of competitors, they're working hard competing against you. And whether it be how you produce it, how you market it, how the logistics, they're spending millions and billions of dollars on doing that better, but so are all your competitors. And so it's pennies a share difference. But when you look at how most businesses are very myopic, focused on just the market, and have tunnel vision, they're like, when it comes to the shapeholders and non-market, like what my daughters refer to my fashion sense, clueless. And so, if you take the example of just the auto industry, even with the little dust-up with the CEO and the SEC, Tesla, which seems to be designed for shapeholders, for the political, the regulatory, the media, they all love it, is the highest market value auto company in the Americas, even though it's by no means the largest. They appealed to shapeholders. On the flip side, VW tried to game the system with the regulators, and as part of that, they lost $26 billion of market value in just 2 days. These are examples of how in the long run, learning how to engage shapeholders is dollars a share. It's the left side of the decimal point. How do we do that? I have a 7-step process for shapeholder success I'm going to go through very quickly. It begins with 3 steps you need to take in order to be prepared for an encounter with shapeholders, and then 4 options once you do. We'll go through them each very briefly. You begin by aligning with a purpose that benefits both you and society. You have to have those two together, and all your engagement with the public should be aligned along that purpose. For example, Nike has as a purpose promoting physical activity. When you promote physical activity, that's good for health, addresses obesity, but oftentimes when they're being physically active, they're using Nike tennis shoes or Nike clothing. On the flip side, Anheuser-Busch InBev focuses on clean water because they've realized that you really can't make beer without water. And if they go into Zimbabwe and take all the water there is to make beer, that isn't going to work very well. So they've aligned with clean water. If Anheuser-Busch and Nike switched their purposes, it wouldn't make any sense. So find a purpose that aligns. You've already talked about the wonderful video you saw of bringing electricity to Africa and what that means. We at the University of North Dakota have as our purpose statement, the foundation of our strategic plan we adapted a year ago, to be the chief opportunity engine for our state and our students. you have on your website to helping develop affordable, reliable, and clean Lignite-generated electricity for you, and the video on Africa showed what a difference that can make. Secondly, you need to anticipate. Things are a lot easier to address earlier on in their life cycle than afterwards. You need to expect the unexpected. You need to follow the example that Mattel found when they all of a sudden woke up one morning to have a big banner hanging over their Los Angeles headquarters with a picture of a Ken doll saying, "Barbie, it's over. I don't date girls that kill rainforests." And this was nothing that Mattel did, or even nothing that Mattel's supplier did, but a supplier of a supplier, the pulp supplier to the packager for Mattel, that got them into trouble. So you need to anticipate what could come after you. You need to figure out what cannons are pointing towards your industry and your company, and you need to look right up the barrel of those cannons and figure out what is it, to see if you can sidestep it or address it. If you're not telling a good story about your industry or company every day, you're going to find like Nike that woke up one morning and found itself being painted as the poster child for child labor. Two examples. Toyota was able to get their Priuses with just one passenger in the high occupancy vehicle lanes in California. And if you think about both Nike's stumble and Toyota's boon, that didn't come from anything they did with the market. It only came with what they did with the non-market in engaging shapeholders, either good or bad. So again, these shapeholders shape the market within which you operate. When you're dealing with shapeholders, you can't take a narrow view. Having a narrow view in a niche market works in business and the market, but it doesn't with shapeholders. You're a product of your own environment, where you grew up, what industry you're in, what your parents do. You're like a submarine that's surrounded by water, just as we're surrounded by the experiences we've had, but it has a periscope that it can see 360 to make sure I'm looking at all the different angles that might impact me. That requires you not just to understand the business aspects or even the business and political aspects, but what's going on globally, which is why the first thing I always advise everybody is to read multiple sources of news, perhaps the Wall Street Journal, whose editorial page I've used a voice of the intelligent right, and the New York Times, which serves that role on the left, and get some international news to broaden your perspective. Because the challenge you're going to have is you not only need to understand those other perspectives, but you need to be able to anticipate them and see around the corner. Because when they come after you with an attack, your company, you, your industry, they have the first mover advantage, and oftentimes the New York minute is 59 seconds too slow. So we've just heard some good news as to what's going on in the regulatory environment with the current administration. But I think we can all anticipate that there's a radical difference between what the current administration thinks about Lignite and what perhaps a Democratic legislation might think about that. You also know it's not hard to anticipate that things change over time. A few states changing, and the whole landscape is different. The landscape we're in the last, this administration is radically different than the last, and it could similarly flip again. Republicans think that you can actually cut back on some of this regulation and still protect water and air. But on the flip side, you're getting a large amount of animosity building up on the other side that thinks that either not enough's being done or perhaps that we're heading in the wrong direction. So what happens? How do we anticipate? How do we prepare for that happening here in the industry? The next thing you need to do is assess. So they might have demands that they want to place on the industry. We need to do two types of assessment. Are they legitimate and can we win? Legitimate takes on two dimensions, morally, right or wrong, or policy, is this good or bad policy? But normally what decides the end of the day is not whether it's legitimate, but can you win? And in that case, you need to go through a cost-benefit analysis for you and for them. What they're trying to do is to have a change of behavior, have a new law, or fundraise. What does it cost them to get you to change? It's identifying, organizing, and motivating enough people coming at you that it forces a change either legislatively or through public opinion. Again, we need to do a cost-benefit analysis. When Shell decided not to drill in the Arctic, it wasn't because of anything that Sierra Club did. They just decided it wasn't economical there. But this is still something that Sierra Club can take credit for and raise money off from. See what we did for Shell, give us more money, and we'll protect you somewhere else. We know, particularly when we're dealing with legitimate of can we win or not, that as it relates to stricter emissions on power plants, that's one of the areas where, as you see here, even on the Republican side, it's an even split between favor and oppose. So very difficult, challenging environment that we have here. Also, if you look at both youth generally, as well as youth on the Republican side, you're finding that they tend to favor the, and let's worry about the environment, as opposed to the affordability and availability of electricity. So we do have reason to say there's a challenge here. When you have those three done, then you have a two-by-two, depending on whether it's legitimate or not, or illegitimate, whether there's a upside possible or downside palatable. Again, I'll go through each very quickly. There are opportunities to advance mutual interest. Take them when you can. An example is Siemens funds engineering education across the globe in 150 or more different countries. Why? Because they sell big, expensive machinery, turbines, and other things. They're not going to sell it to Angola if Angola doesn't have anybody that knows how to run it. So if they invest in engineering in Angola, that helps the student, that helps the university, it helps the country, but it also helps Siemens. In a similar way, there's a number of stuff that we do with you. I was very pleased to see this handsome guy in the middle of the slide there talking about research. In many ways, the research we're doing is very good for us in discovery at the University of North Dakota, but it's good for you. When you look at, there's already been some mention of getting rare earths out of coal, that increases the value of coal, the purpose of coal, and helps it have a bigger, broader meaning than the slides that we just talked about in the polling. When you look at, this is an example of national mining, talking about bringing that down to troop safe, because we know that the countries we're reliant on these rare earths are not necessarily ones we want to be relying on, and it affects not just commercial, but security applications. Also, when we're dealing with carbon capture or carbon sequestration, all of those research areas, again, it's wonderful and that you're working with the University of North Dakota and others on that, but it also makes your industry much more viable long-term vis-a-vis all of those polls that we just saw. And we're hoping, as you know, President Bresciani and I are here in town as we're going across the region talking about more research to the research universities of NDSU and UND can help us do more positive goods. One of the ones we'd really like to do more work on is a smart grid. We think that could be a huge benefit to your industry and other industries if we could do that. So there are win-win opportunities, and we saw Stacy there from Minkota in terms of what we can do with drones to make your power lines more safe and quickly repair them and alert yourself to changes you can make. Sometimes it's legitimate, but it really doesn't help you, but you can accept it. If you look at the soda companies, say we're not responsible for obesity, but what they did was their defense is that it's an individual choice. So to empower individual choices, even though government doesn't require them, Pepsi, Coke, Snapple, everybody got together and said, we're going to put the calorie count on individual servings so that we've given the information to the individuals to make the right decisions. This isn't required. If all of a sudden there was such a bubbling of action required that Congress needed to do something, they could require this. They've shown the way and they've averted worse things from happening. In a similar way, there's a number of clean air laws that you are, and we're proud that here in North Dakota, we're doing a good job of embracing those, that averting worse things from happening by embracing those and doing the wonderful stewardship that we're doing around the state. The third area is acquiesce. Sometimes they're asking you to do something illegitimate and it's just not worth the fight or you can't win. If anybody who's read the book Heidi knows that the Swiss think that their milk is better than North Dakota milk or Minnesota or Wisconsin milk, you could spend a lot of money convincing them of that, but is it worth it? Which is why we all knew that McDonald's was Swiss. They've just decided it's not worth it. I'm just going to buy all my milk from Switzerland that I sell in Switzerland. The challenge, though, is when we get down, when we have to assemble to win, where we're having an illegitimate request or demand imposed on our company or our industry, and we have to go to battle because it's just existential to our existence, or we think we can win. How do we do that? That's the complicated part. That begins with my assemble matrix of why, what, where, who, how, when. Let me just begin with what and where. And when you're dealing with these types of challenges or any political battle, it's always a question over the question. The question wins. The question is always the answer. If you're talking answers, you're losing. If you're answering somebody else's question, you're losing. You need to invest all your time on getting the right question. And I want to just play a little short snippet here from Thank You for Smoking to give you an example.
What happens when you're wrong?
No, Joey, I'm never wrong.
But you can't always be right.
Well, if it's your job to be right, then you're never wrong.
But what if you are wrong?
Okay, let's say that you're defending chocolate and I'm defending vanilla. Now, if I were to say to you, vanilla is the best flavor ice cream, you'd say,
no, chocolate is.
Exactly. But you can't win that argument. So, I'll ask you. So you think chocolate is the end-all and be-all of ice cream, do you?
It's the best ice cream. I wouldn't order any of it.
Oh, so it's all chocolate for you, is it?
Yes, chocolate is all I need.
Well, I need more than chocolate. And for that matter, I need more than vanilla. I believe that we need freedom and choice when it comes to our ice cream. And that, Joy Naylor, that is the definition of liberty.
But that's not what we're talking about.
Ah, but that's what I'm talking about.
But you didn't prove that vanilla is the best.
I didn't have to. I proved that you're wrong. And if you're wrong, I'm right.
But you still didn't convince me.
It's that I'm not after you. I'm after them.
Which highlights the importance of making sure you know who the audience is, the who, and what the question is that you're trying to get. Let me give you an example of recently the media companies, those who make your movies and music. I know none of you or your kids ever stole any music or movies, but they're worried about that. And today it's illegal for people in this country to do it, but not foreign websites. So they wanted to pass a law to ban foreign websites helping Americans. So their question was, should U.S. companies assist foreign companies in stealing U.S. property? That was their question. And where they asked it was in Congress. They had strong support on both sides of the aisle, including many of the leaders in Congress, in the House and the Senate. They'd already passed the Senate committee. It was heading to vote and likely to win, when all of a sudden, new media came, and it had a different question. It didn't want to have these standards imposed on them, so they asked the question, do you want the federal government to block out your internet access? And they skipped past Congress. They went to public opinion, and they had a Black Tuesday, shut down all their websites, and told the viewers that were trying to go to their websites, call your congressman and tell them to kill SOPA and PIPA. And so a bill that was almost certain to pass is dead and not likely to be recovered. Why? Because new media had a better question asked in a different location. You look at global warming, for example. What's the question? What's the arena? To date so far, the question on those pushing it is, don't you want to stop the seas from rising? That's their question. And where are they asking that? Largely in one form or another in a UN-sponsored organization. On the flip side, others on the other side are saying, yeah, there's environment, but is it worth the cost? So they're going to the point of What do we agree on? What do Republicans and Democrats, conservatives and liberals agree on? They agree that these jobs are important. So they say, the question is, do you want to kill jobs or save jobs? And where are they asking it? Largely in public opinion of late, as well as the U.S. Senate. And as you can see, all the red lights are lined up on the U.S. Senate. The U.S. Senate is a body where it's easier to kill something than advance something. To date, it's largely been a stalemate here in the country because of this. You're also pressing the economic impact on your website and what that means, as is National Mining Association. Here's an example of doing a lousy job. They're talking about tar sands from Canada, but they're doing it in Brussels, and Brussels really doesn't buy, or Europe doesn't buy, any real oil from Canada, so they're just creating a lot of steam, even though it probably won't have much effect on Canada. Who? One of my favorite slides, cookies and milk. Very different from one another, but they go very well together. Cookies are crunchy, milk is liquid. Similarly, when you're building a coalition for getting done what you want to get done, those that are most different from you are most valuable. You're going to ultimately need to get a majority of the people in the House or the Senate. If you're just talking coal people from coal states, that's a pretty narrow coalition. When I deal with activists, I divide activists into two categories. Cared activists that actually want to entice you to be more responsible at what you do. And even though this lion looks ferocious, in many ways, in many areas, Wildlife Federation has been that actor that's picked people to work with. Then there's stick activists that don't want to deal with you at all. They just want to find somebody doing something bad and beat them over the head, make it miserable for them, just to keep them or anybody else from even thinking about doing that. Even though this lady looks nice and friendly, Greenpeace is an example of these organizations that just want to beat you over the head. If you can find cared activists that you can work with on this topic, you'll find that when you're up against the barricades on some difficult issue for you, that you'll have other teams coming around you, and they'll help guide you out of getting in those situations in the first place. When we're dealing with the energy industries that you're talking about here, it's particularly difficult. You need to have a wider perspective of who you're pulling into your coalition if you're going to win, particularly if we have a flip of what's going on in Washington. You need to be charting out who are the members, who's with, what issue are they with us and for us or against us, who's talking to them, what aspect of our operations would really appeal to them. One of the more interesting things is American Petroleum Institute pulled together all of the energy sources to work on a comprehensive energy bill, including wind and hydro and other renewable sources, because they say we all have similar issues and together we're stronger than pulled apart. Similarly, I'll deal with oil because I have more slides on oil than coal, although I have some good coal slides I could put in here as well. Who supports oil? Where do you think this rig is at? This rig is sitting in the Capitol parking lot in Oklahoma. And if you go into the Oklahoma Senate, you walk in and they have a drill rig there. So you know you can find support in Oklahoma. But you need to go beyond that. For example, the 9.2 million people who have jobs and all the people around them. But even more than that, the 168 million people who have homes that they're heating and they want that to be reliable and accessible. Or those that might worry about, is there going to be a shortage? That reliability, those of us who are old enough to remember the shortages we've had before. So you need to pull those all together and have as big a broad a coalition as you can. And then how? It can't all just be paid media, because paid media is hard to get out to a broad group, very expensive. Here's an example where the New York Times tried to buy their way into the rack. If you take a close look at the rack, even though they paid for the rack, there's no New York Times. So you need to have very targeted messaging to the right people with the right message. And too many people think it's just go talk to your legislature, go talk to your congressman. But frankly, I can tell you, having been a congressman, if you're not from my district, I don't care. You're much better off bringing people from the members' district into their office and saying this is important for them. And you need to have your messaging. These messages aren't wasted, they're in capitals. You see Exxon talking here in Brussels. You see the oil and natural gas industry advertising at the bus stop, you know, not in Miami, but in Washington, D.C. And then once the bus comes, they're also advertising on the bus. And once you go down the subway, if you choose that, as you're walking down, you're hearing the messages. And again, the messages are always the same. It's always jobs, affordability, reliability. You walk down on the floor of the subway. You go by the walls in the subway. You're getting down the escalator on the subway. And then when you get on the subway, then Shell picks up the message. So you are at critical times going to need to do pointed, focused messaging, unity, not just your industry, but all the other related industries and company working in harmony. And here on TV, going after that cost issue and making sure people understand that you vote. You need to, in this case, use your stakeholders, your employers, your employees, your suppliers, your communities to help get your message out and not get confused by other messages. And that requires making sure you can reach them on that iPhone right away so they don't get confused and so that they activate their action. And if you don't know how to use one of those fancy new things, ask your son-in-law and he'll show you how. So I hope I've shown a new dimension, that it's more than just what happens in the boardrooms or in the mines or in dealing with your customers. It has to do with what's happening on TV, what's happening in the Capitol, what is happening on social media, and you need to be aware of that. We're facing some very serious headwinds, perhaps not now, but perhaps not too distant in the future. And in many ways, we're at a pivot point, but I believe we can avoid that crash up if we learn how to balance all those interests, the shareholders' interests, the true stakeholders' interests, your employees, your consumers, and the shapeholders' interests, and tap that inner urge within all of us to be the superhero, to dive in, and put that puzzle piece that makes a better world for all of our children. Thank you all very much, and I'd be happy to take your questions. Any questions that people want to have here? And I will also say that I'll have books for sale as you go to the right afterwards, with all proceeds going to the great University of North Dakota, if you want to learn more.
I was curious about a protest here in Bismarck, Mann, a couple years ago, and I would assume you would say they did a terrible job of working with shapeholders and trying to get their message across. What would you suggest the DAPL, the pipeline company, should have done to better message that incident?
Well, first of all, it's best never to get into a fight or to fight. If you look through the chapter on Assemble to Win, I go through the Sun Tzu, Art of War, and you want to be on the sunny side of the hill. So if you anticipate ahead of time, they're going to pick your weakest spot. They're not going to hit you at the strongest spot. They're going to put your weakest spot. So where do they hit Keystone? They hit it in the sand hills in Nebraska. Where do you hit the DAPL? You hit it on a tribal reservation going under the water. If you want to build a pipeline, what do? The first segment you build is the more controversial part, before the controversy can build up, so you're in the open fields of the rest of North Dakota. So that was a case where they'd seen what happened at Keystone, didn't anticipate that they're going to pick the weakest spot of a pipeline to go and just go there first. That's just one example of how anticipating it makes sense. The other thing that you hear over and over, they'll do an accusation and people answer the accusation. When you're answering their question, you're losing. You're not talking about how much safer it is to transport this versus the lives that might be lost on rail. That should be your question. Isn't this the safest way to transport this? They weren't battling questions with questions. They were answering questions that they should have been instead focusing energies on going after a different question and having that out there and getting it out there ahead of time, not in reaction. But I haven't spent a lot of time thinking about it. They keep me quite busy at the University of North Dakota. Those are just a couple of off-the-top examples from the book. Other questions? Other questions? Comments? Insults? If not, again, I very much appreciate the opportunity to come and speak to you here today. I'd be happy to chat to you, any of you at the table outside. Thank you so much.
President Kennedy, thank you very much for that presentation. And again, book sales will be available out here in the exhibitor area. Okay, ladies and gentlemen, that concludes today's meeting, but not all the festivities are over at this time. I do want to bid you farewell and thank you for attending today. And I do encourage you to participate in the social next door, right now, next door in Hall B. Beverages and food will be served until 6 p.m. Thank you very much.